All right, and then we can cut out the start or whatever nonsense we come out at the beginning, you know. This is a pretty good connection, you know. I've interviewed some people from like Birmingham here in the Midlands, and it's been cutting out. I interviewed Tubbsy the other day, and I had some really bad technical issues with Tubbsy, which is ironic since he's in a band and he knows mute sound, and you know, and myself as well, and we just kept messing it up. But I knew you had a podcast before. Do you still have your podcast going? Do you?
No, once I move, I'm in the middle of a move.
Ah.
I kind of did what you did. I'm moving like away from the city. I'm going 4 hours away into kind of like what we call, it's like lakes, it's the Okanagan.
Nice.
So once I move, set up, and then I'll probably do something again.
And set it back up on that. Yeah, but you got a great background as well. Mine's kind of falling apart at the moment. It's falling down.
Mine's in the middle of a move. You can see some empty sections, but...
Right, Aman Panessa, well done. I'm so happy to have you on the show. Finally, this has only taken me 5 years to make this happen. It has been 5 years, you know.
You know what, man? First of all, thank you. I really appreciate the opportunity. And I've been a fan of yours since day one. You're probably thinking, day one podcast? No, man. I remember when you were on radio, okay? Yes, with Shinji C. I actually used to work at my mama's Ferrari garage just down the road from the station there.
I know that one.
That was my Saka mama, yeah? So I used to listen to you a lot all the time. I actually came up to their station there poaching, looking for a job once or twice. But that worked out. But, you know, I've known of you for a while. Been a huge fan. So, and I commend you on what you're doing, man. Like, even when you started the British Asian podcast, it was... For at the time that you started, it was absolutely remarkable. Something needed, and I'm really glad you started up again. It's awesome.
Yeah, Aman, thanks. I appreciate that. You've always been a great supporter of mine, even from across the pond. And you do your bit. You know, you share, you like, and you always comment, and you're always tagging me into brown Twitter. How long did I last? 5 minutes before I said brown Twitter. Oh
man, straight for it, man.
We won't go in that rabbit hole just yet.
No worries.
We'll circle around it for a bit. But thank you. And you have been a great supporter. And 2015 is when I started, as you know. And since that time, there's been so many podcasts have come up and started. Some have gone. Some are still around. I think it's become, it's more well known now, would you say?
Yeah, it's great. I mean, I remember... You know, we had this discussion, and when I found you, it was like, wow, like this is a revelation. There's actually people out there podcasting. And to be fair, I mean, this has got nothing to do with like trying to, you know, disrespect anyone, but we were one of the first, and we needed more, you know, like we were just a stepping stone, which hopefully gives. Because, I mean, podcasting is it, bro. Like, you can click on it, rewind it, you know, while you're working out, go anywhere. It's to me, especially if you're an audio person, it's the best format. And it's the best format to get your views across, your points across, guests across. And I thoroughly enjoyed it, and I really miss it. I really do. Just because of... you know, some stuff that's been happening in my life, been really busy. I had to put it aside for now. But like I said, once I do this personal move of mine with the family, hopefully I can start again. But I commend you for that, man. Like it takes a lot of work. It's a lot of effort. Mm. And, you know, the guests that you had on your show was what kept me, you know, watching you because, you know, like we had the discussion about the episode with Bindi, the whole movement. You know, recently just on WhatsApp, and you know, I would had no idea about that stuff.
Yes.
So
same here. I mean, that was probably one of my harder interviews because I do kind of have I have a bit of a dry sense of humor. So I try and make light of things, but that was something completely outside my comfort zone. And but I was so more well informed afterwards, and I felt like I've learned something. I genuinely learned something. I thought, you know, I'm actually better for knowing this now. And for people listening who are not sure what we're talking about, it's Binti Period, a charity that helps people not just in third world countries but around the world, basically, with sanitary towels and women's menstruation education. Hopefully, I'm not messing that up, ruining their brand.
Yeah, but I think,
that's pretty much it, right? And but that was the kind of conversations I did. And when I started this one, I wanted it to be slightly more conversational rather than a journey of someone's life. And because there is so much happening, I mean, 2020 is unbelievable. I mean, I've read somewhere if aliens were to land now, no one would really give a shit because it's just the next thing, right?
Yeah, I'd be like, this is absolute chaos. I'm like, what I land into, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But it, you know, the important part of whatever you're doing, and you've seen my tweets about this, is you're documenting us in the UK, right? Because it's going to be lost in translation. You know, that stuff is really important because no one else is going to do it for us.
Really, No.
You know, if you think, you know, the Gore are going to do it, they're not going to do it. You know what I mean? Like, it's really important that we take the initiative. And that's why, like, I say this personally like that. And I commend you on this because it's not easy. Right. And whatever you're doing is for the betterment of our community and the culture, because, you know, 30 years from now, you know, people are watching this episode, you know, it's documented. And it maybe it'll help someone, or maybe, you know, reflect on something. And we never had that growing up. Like, like all we had was audio cassettes, and that was our sort of, you know, touch. Obviously radio, right? But that was it. Once that Kentao was finished, it was gone. You know. So I think, like I was saying, like this, and obviously like video, what you're doing now, it's really important that we as a culture start documenting our history.
Yeah.
I think it's critical.
I think you're right. And I think the big distinction between podcasting and radio, I like radio, you know, that's my background originally, long time ago. But the only issue I have with radio, it's kind of, you can get into a deep conversation about something and you've got to cut off and say, look, we've got to stop it now. I've just got to go to the news, you know, and, or I've just got to cut it there. I've just got to play the ads, you know, and it'll just fuck up the interview, right? And I remember my first interview that I did on Punjab Radio actually was with Shukshinda Shinda. Now, yeah, I'd never interviewed anyone in my life, right? On radio. And and it was Shukshinda Shinda and Meshi Ashara. Yeah, he came with him, right? So both of them. And I knew them, obviously, I knew of their songs. And this was when Shinda was just coming into singing. So he's just about releasing his first album. And Shin GC wasn't there. I don't know where he went. He just left me. And I thought, I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know what knobs I'm pressing. I'm going to miss the news. Because I was kind of, he was the main controller of the desk, right? So I didn't really know what was going on with the desk. And I would just talk nonsense, basically. And anyway, I don't know what he had to do, some secret mission he was on, who knows. But I was left with Shukshinda Shinda. And that was my first real interview. And I loved it because I think my first question was, because I was so nervous, I said, look, you can play literally any instrument. You're a good-looking guy. You can sing now. And is there anything you can't do? Right. And he looked at me and he just started laughing, right? Because I don't think anyone had asked him a question in that way before. And he just started laughing and we just got on afterwards. Even after the show, we started chatting and but something clicked in my head. I thought, I love that. I love talking to people and I want to know about what album they're releasing and that kind of thing. I want to know more about them. And I was restricted on the show because I only had like 15 minute little slots within the hour. And but when podcasting came, I thought, what, there's no time limit and I can swear without worrying and I could I could just talk normally like we would in a bar or in a coffee shop, you know, about life. And I had no producer. I've got no boss. And I had the equipment. And I looked around for Desi podcasts when I started off. And Canada, I would say, were a few steps ahead of the UK. And I think they have been for a while now. Would you agree?
I would say so, yeah. I mean, like I said, on the British side of things, you were the only one that I knew of at the time. In terms of like culture podcasts, there was like, you know, people talking about entrepreneurship or whatever there was, you know. But in terms of getting down to the nitty gritty, and you hit the nail on the head. The reason why I podcast, because I could ask them the questions that I wanted to know. Versus like, oh, Paji, to see I, you know, thoda show, adoa, thoda show kithea, ek do to see, you know, lion, to see marje gadio. Like, that's not me, man. I want to know what your favorite color is, what car you drive, your struggles, you know, how you are in life. And,
exactly.
You know, yeah. Like, I can honestly say, I mean, I didn't do many interviews because for some reason, no one ever wanted to come to my show for interviews. I can probably guess why, right? I'm a pretty straightforward guy. And the ones that did, afterwards, they'd always said, this is one interview I'll never forget, because it was about them. It wasn't about the music per se or their release. It was like, you know, I want you to come in and encourage someone to pick it up an instrument. Telling someone is one thing, but actually giving a reason why, you know, like I tell everyone, to me, when they say, why'd you start DJing? I go, it's not important why I started DJing or like when I started DJing, because it saved my life. You know, but it put me through school. It put me through college. It paid for my bills. You know, sure, you got to have some sort of talent. Don't get me wrong. I mean, you know, that's life is. But, you know, DJing was to fight racism, you know. And for me personally, DJing was about playing the music that I wanted to hear. You know, my background, like I am Canadian born. So I'm born and raised in Canada, but I was raised in the UK. I worked there, went to school there, and then I came back. So but you know, music wise and culture wise, but I live here. So when I was DJing here, all I ever played was UK stuff. So it was really hard because this is a Pindu city here, right? Like this is hardcore thisy. So the clientele that I had, I can honestly say, you know, like I wasn't someone's jukebox. When you paid me, like you booked me and you got UK Bhangra Punjabi music, and I made my career out of that. And I got to play, I'm very fortunate that I got to play the records that I wanted to hear. And I got to, you know, play like any new stuff that came from the UK. And, you know, like we were the pioneers of bringing that music here. I'm gonna be frank, right? Because otherwise it was, you know, traditional stuff from Punjab or like, you know, the really dissy records from Mulkeet. But I'm talking like, you know, the Rishi Rich records, the Apache Indian records, anything that's like kind of crossover, you know, R&B, pop, and urban. We used to blast those at parties here. And that's why, you know, that was really important to me, that I got to, you know, do my thing, but also showcase other types of music. Cause I'm so pro, you know, for the underdog. Like that's, you know, reminisce that brand, that me is helping someone who's never going to get a chance to, you know, give an opportunity. And podcasting did the same thing for me. Exactly your words, you know, like for example, you know, why I connected with you is because you're just a regular guy that just want to showcase your British people and their talent for what they actually are, their struggles, their journey. And that to me is really interesting, right? Like I don't care necessarily, you know, how many albums you made. I want to know your struggles of making the albums. Like, you know,
exactly.
Like when you talk about like, oh, I was in the studio with XYZ, you know, or laying down this pattern and, you know, like I just couldn't get it. Then all of a sudden some guy over there said one word and I was like, boom, okay. Gana, you know, gana ho gaya. You know what I mean? That's the kind of stuff that's interesting to me.
Exactly. It's them backstories that I'm always interested in. And I know exactly what you mean. Sometimes I do get guests still on here, especially from the Bhangra scene, who would say, do you want me to sing a few lines? That's not really my thing, but I let them. I don't mind, you know, sure. That's their time. But I'm more about a conversation. And it's interesting how I find certain people are very reluctant, upper name people, to talk about anything other than what they're on for. So it's hard to have that natural conversation because I might ask them, you know, what do you think about Trump? You know, the guy's crazy. What about Kanye? You know, he's You know,
what, good to see you doing that too.
Yeah, what about The Rock? I reckon The Rock should be president, you know, if anyone, you know. And but they won't divert from their sort of message because they're so used to being on radio and that single message. My album's coming out. I've got an R&B track. I've got a reggae track. It used to be I got a garage track, you know, back in the day, right? Yeah. And I used to get bored of that kind of conversation, you know. So I am a regular guy. I don't try to be a presenter. I'm not very polished. I don't mind that. And when I started, that kind of became my style. And it fit in with podcasting because that's what it was. It was kind of the Wild West. It's rough and ready. And I know some of the newer podcasts now are very polished. And I know you're a sound engineer. And you must hear some of my shows and think, what the fuck? This sounds awful here at certain parts. But they're so polished. They're so radio. They're so BBC, right? And
yeah,
it's kind of not the true essence of podcasting. Would you agree?
I agree with you. It's just basically a recorded radio, right? You can play it anytime. And I mean, it is what it is. I mean, yeah, I'm a sound engineer and, you know, but I have the gear, so it's different for me, right? Like, and my whole thing was for me, because I was adding music to my shows, I didn't want the music aspect of it to sound really bad. Because the thing with audio and, like, not to get technical here, the thing with anything, right? Like, you can make a video and put on YouTube, but if the audio is subpar, they're going to skip it.
Mm.
Right. So, I mean, Sai, you don't have nothing to worry about. Your podcasts are fine. Like, I'm telling you, because I listen to them, there's nothing, you know, where I wouldn't, like, if there was, I would have messaged you. That's
just what you would. Yeah.
You know, I would have been like, hey, bro, turn your mic down. No, I'm just joking. But it's just one of those things, right? Like, people don't understand. I guess me being an engineer, it's like the natural ear is very good at picking up stuff it doesn't like. Like, I'm sure you've been on the dance floor and the DJ does something, like, you know, you twitch and you're like, what the hell just happened, right? Even though you can't really comprehend what it is, it's just your ear telling you that it's out of key or the beat didn't match or whatever it is. So when people hear, you know, I mean, you got to be like recording, you know, speakerphone like this or something really brutal in a windy situation for a podcast to be really bad. Mm. I mean, most of the time you can hit it bang on. Like, I've done podcasts, honestly, where I've interviewed people just on my phone, put on speaker, and we're having a conversation.
Right.
Right. So, I agree with you there 100%. I think, you know, like you said, there needs to be more. I don't know why we don't. That's a good question, actually. It's something I can't even answer. You know, like, everyone's got a decent laptop. You don't need a crazy microphone. You can actually record right into here, like I said, and just get your thoughts out.
Mm.
You know, I don't know if it's a cultural thing that we don't like, you know, maybe some fresh wounds. Like, I it's really hard to say. I guess I've always been outspoken. You know, I've always been, you know, like, you know, that's not how it should be. It should be like this, not opinionated, but like, you know, like, I don't agree with what you're doing. And I've always been that way. And I find culturally we're very reserved. You know, we like to kind of, you know, not provoke the bear or, you know, poke the bear, and we, you know, bury shit under the table. So it was refreshing to hear someone like yourself when you're kind of like, you know, poking the bear and asking these questions, and you're just like, holy shit, the guy asked my question, I'm over the answers it. And, you know, and when you get the right guest on, they do, because, you know, they want to let some steam out too, right? It's just how you do it.
Yeah. There's always a point in some, especially this earlier shows in the British Asian podcast, where I think there's 10, 15 minutes into the interview, it suddenly dawns on them that they can say absolutely anything. And I'm not going to be shocked. Usually I instigate it, you see. So I would say something, and they're like, you know, whether it be about drinking or my past or drugs or whatever it is, right? And they'll be like, he's been quite open. So they kind of get on board. Not everyone, but
yeah,
some of them get on board and think, well, he's been quite open. I might share something as well. It's kind of a ninja trick, I would say. But it was never my intention to be that way. I kind of just, if I'm talking to someone, I'm kind of open anyway, and I've got nothing really to to hide. I know, I mean, you mentioned, I think for the benefit of people listening, you said you're a sound engineer. I want to kind of know how you, because I don't know this either, how you got into that. And I know you've worked with some great artists as well that you, hopefully you'll mention as well. Because like, don't be shy, because I know you are.
No, of course. I mean, I guess for the love of music, it just started with my dad, you know, like all that vinyl collection behind me. I mean, he probably going to hate me for saying this, but it was because of him. You know, we had the very first music shop, the video shop here in Vancouver. Like, we were the first. It's called, wow, the Video Shop on Main Street, which is going to be like kind of like a heritage.
Yeah.
What was it called? Punjabi. It's called Video Shop on the Punjabi Market on Main Street.
That is Punjabi and a half. You're going to open, yeah, a video shop. And you, so you're sitting around and you're thinking, what should I call this? I'm going to call it the Video Shop.
Yes.
You're genius.
Yeah. Yeah, so he and I've got actually in the, I can't get to it in the corner there, my dad, like all his vinyls I've kept. So he's got, you know, like all these Hindi and Punjabi vinyls, and you know, and it's just one of those things, right, where your father has never really wanted you to follow in their footsteps culturally, yeah, right? I'm sure it's other cultures too. I can only talk about us. And you know, it was my dream to like work in the shop, because I, you know, with my love of music. But then he sold it, and that's fine. And then from there, I was still, you know, there. And then when I went to school, I was like part of the A, you know, the AV team setting up sound. And then, you know, I was like, I bought a set of like really cheap turntables, and I just started messing around at home, mainly hip hop at the time. And then, you know, did a couple of dances here and there, nothing crazy. It was only until, I would say I still remember, it was Eric Hamber, is a school out here, it was a high school dance. And at that time, there's three main DJs here, Maximus Clean, Earl the Pearl, and DJ Dave. And I just set up the sound for them, and then they would do their thing. And I was DJing, they knew who I was. And then it was just me and Max that night. And Max is like, bro, I need to go to the bathroom. You know what to do. I'll leave. Like, what we used to do is, you know, those milk crates. You've seen those milk crates. We used to put the records in there. Mm. And basically, every record you want to play, you put on an angle so you could see it. So he goes, there's a bunch of records there. Don't worry. I'll be back. I'll be back in like 5 minutes. Just play the next one. Okay. And I'm crapping myself, right? I must have been, what? I can't remember. 14, 15 years old, I think. 16, whatever it was. And, you know, he's like, but I'll be back. And I'm sitting there, and the, you know, the needle's going, and you can see it going near the end. I'm like, you know, shit, he ain't coming back. So yeah. I cue the next song, and I couldn't mix for shit, right?
Yeah.
I just played the next song, and people are like coming up to me with the requests and stuff, and I'm freaking out, right? And I'm like, okay, right? I go, the DJ's coming back, just give him a minute. And then he didn't come again. And then the song's starting to end. So I grab another one to put it on, right? And this went like four or five times, and I'm like I'm sweating, I'm crazy. And I look at the back, and there he is in the back, like laughing at me. And he's going like this. That was my initiation to DJ. Yeah. And he's like, congratulations, you're now a DJ. And that was it. I was hooked. And I was probably that time at, you know, proud or not, it doesn't matter. 14, 15, 16, I was DJing in clubs. Yeah. It was my way of making income.
Do you think he done that on purpose, or did he really need to go for a shit or something?
No, I think he did want to go to the bathroom, but at the same time, he was kind of lazy too, and he kind of teach me a lesson. And I think also as well, because he was moving out of the province. So I live in BC. He was going to another province over in Alberta. And honestly, as much as I hated him at the time, it was a really nice gesture, like giving me that sort of thing. I think it was like, okay, you've earned your stripes. Now here's your initiation. Yeah. And he was nice, man. He hooked me up with all the record pools and stuff like that. So like all that vinyl you see back there was all like...
He's kind of like the parent who throws his child into the swimming pool.
Yeah.
Goes, swim. Yeah,
that was basically it. He's like, swim. And then after that, I was hooked. I just started spending all my earnings on vinyls. And, you know, I got with him, I got into the clubs at a really young age. You know, something I'm not really proud of at the end of the day, but it is what it is. You know, I was DJing 14, 15, 16, 17, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday nights, making great money. You know, usual, parents aren't happy about it. You know, munda school ni parda, you know, I was still studying, but you know, I'm coming home at like 3, 4 in the morning, got to get it for school. But I was never, you know, I can honestly say I never took advantage of it. Like I just did my thing, came home, and then just started building a name. And then how I got into the Punjabi scene, this is funny. So Bali Sagu was in town. I had no idea who this guy was, right? And he was up playing at this club called 86th Street. And I am on before him, right? Because being Punjabi, you know Punjabi. So, like, you know, we're going to book you. Just go on before him, do some stuff. I'm like, okay. This guy comes on, yeah? And he's got hip-hop records mixing on top of Punjabi records. And I'm just, like, staring at this guy. I'm like, holy shit, what is this guy doing? Like, I was mesmerized. Like, it takes a lot to, like, kind of, like, I was, like, literally, like this. And the guy's like, you know, what the fuck's your problem? You know what I mean? Like, why are you looking on my shoulder?
Yeah.
I'm like, sorry, dude. Like, this is amazing. Like, and I asked him a couple of questions. That was it. I was buying vinyls, like, by the crates from the UK. Mm. And that's when I got into the Punjabi scene, because I was the only one doing vinyls in, like, North America. And I still, to this day, when I gig, I only do vinyls, right?
Right.
I couldn't get into the CD thing or the MP3 thing. I mean, now we got software, but same idea. I'm still using turntables. And I was just, it was like from here, just like that exponential, like, okay, this guy's a shit. We're going to book him. And that's where all the, because you can only get UK Bhangra Punjabi vinyl. Mm. So that's where my start came from. And I was just breaking barriers at that point. It was awesome. Like, it was a good run of my 50, 20 years where we're just... It was like, yeah. Wow. Like, people used to come to the shows and be like, holy shit.
So seeing Bali Sagu, and you saw him with his R&B and hip hop records and his Punjabi, he's putting the two together. And was it just like a light bulb moment thinking, fucking hell, you can do that?
Honestly, it was. I was like, holy shit. First of all, I you know, like, I was listening to Punjabi music going around. Like, my first cassette was Hida's Diamonds from Hida, right? Like, classic, you know what I mean? Like, classic. The one that I paid for, but dad was, we also listened to Punjabi songs in the car and stuff. So Punjabi, which I was already, but I never thought of DJing, because I thought, man, I don't want to DJ weddings. You know what I mean? That's not me. I'm a club DJ, right? But then this guy comes on, and honestly, I don't know what happened. Like, I was like, you know, it's like, how do you describe it? It's like, I don't know, going to the auto show and you see that one car you've always dreamt of. I'm just like, holy shit, that's it. That's what I want. Mm. And when I saw this, I was like, you know what? This guy's the man. And I bought, like, all his CDs and stuff. Like, he was my idol. Like, to this day, because of him, is who I am. If I had not have seen him or met him, you know, like, there's no way I'd be who I am today. Like, I owe all my whole success to the fact that I got to see him live. And that's the truth. Mm. If I never would have seen him, I never would have DJed Punjabi stuff. Because I didn't want anything to do with the community. I didn't. Because I was so much into hip-hop. Like, I'm a hip-hop head, right? Mm. And I still do hip-hop parties. And, like, he was the one that kept me into the culture. That's the straight truth. It was the music. 100%.
Have you ever seen him since, or have you met him, had a chance to talk to him about this?
Yeah, I did. Because he was Bali Sagu. Basically, I talked to his bodyguard more than I talked to him. But, you know, shit aside, it was like, you know, I said to him, I go, you know what? You knew you're like my idol and this and that. And he's like, yeah, and, you know, did his thing. I'm not hating on the guy. I'm just saying, I wish I had an opportunity to actually sit down with him, have a real conversation. Maybe one day, you know, maybe one day I'd love that. But, you know, at some point, you know, when with his success, and I'm not hating on him, because I can understand what he goes through. Like, I work in the studio. I've worked with everybody you can think of. You know what I mean? So kind of progression from DJing was I started being an intern at a recording studio, and it was funny. So I kind of know where these guys, like he had people around him all the time. You get to a point where you're like, I don't want to talk to anybody. You know what? So it is, well, like, I'm not angry about it, but kind of progression from that was, I really wanted to be, you know, somewhere in the music game. And I kind of figured out early that I want to be in the background. Like, I learned classical, I played harmonium, I learned how to sing, you know, and I just couldn't do it. Like, the stage fright killed me. Like, I just couldn't do it. You know, but I use my background to, you know, work in the studio. And then it's funny at that time.
Are you going to sing? Are you going to sing a song? Yeah.
But at that time, the racism was so bad. Like, this is probably late 80s, early 90s, where I couldn't even get an intern in any studio whatsoever. Right. I mean, I'm blaming that because it's, you know, like, I was better than, like, I'm not boasting or bragging, but the experience that I had, I felt I was better than most candidates. And it wasn't until, and this is funny, and it wasn't until I ran into Len at Fiasco Brothers. Fiasco Brothers is basically the Planet Studios of Canada.
Right. Okay.
This guy's recorded everybody. Shinda, Jazzy, Harpajamon, you name it. So I happened to just go there, knock on the door. And at that time, Sung Thad from the Wattis Brothers, he was one of the engineers there. And I said to him, I go, look, I'm looking for an intern. I'll do anything. I'll make Jachu, Joe Majima. You know, I just want to get in the game. Because I was a big fan of the 24-track tape machines, and he had one. So I want to work in a studio where I can actually learn how to record the tape. And he goes, you know what, man? He goes, yeah, come, man. I need some help because we got some, you know, it's like Punjabi singers are coming and I need some help. I had no idea it was Jazzy B and Shinda.
Wow.
Yeah. So I got to work on his first two albums. Yeah. I was an intern. I got to work on like anyone from Canada, like you name it, I've probably worked on something. So that to me was like, wow. And and I learned so much from, and I still go there once in a while now, like just to hang out. And, you know, anytime I record vocals, I'll go to Len just because he's my boy. Right.
Yeah.
And it was cool. And I got to learn the ropes, learn to actually record live. And that really helped me to where I propelled and got my own sort of mix studio now.
Yeah. So that the Jazzy B and Shinda album was what? Kogiana Jorda, was it?
Or, that one, yeah. The first album, yeah.
Yeah. Amazing. Yeah. What did you think of Jazzy B at the time?
Let me tell you something, man. So I've known Jazzy from before he met Shinda because he used to come around and he's just a weird looking kid, skinny little kid in his Mazda Presidia. I still remember like this, that Jazzy B is a license plate because I used to work at a petrol station, gas station here, and he used to come in and get fuel from me. And I thought, well, yeah, whatever. I mean, you know, just typical brown attitude, right? This guy's in the studio sitting in the corner. Shinda's there. And was it Shrinda Shinda? I can't remember. It's been so long. But anyways, gal hogi ke, you know, marg di galla hogiya, right? And Shinda's like, oh, you gotta listen to this kid. He goes, he sounds just like him. And, you know, he's pretty powerful. Skinny little kid in the corner, bro. Hair all like fucked up, whatever. Right? Jazzy style. And I'm sitting there, you know, whatever. I can't remember what I was doing in the control room. And he goes, do line nagala. Buddy, this guy absolutely smashed it. I was like, holy fuck, where'd the vocals come out of this kid? Right? This guy just stands up random, like straight face, and just started belting Manik Diya Kalinya. Right? And I was like, holy. I go, and I said, I looked at, you know, Sung Thad, I think, was there too. We're just looking at each other. This guy's going to make it one day. Lo and behold, man, crown prince of Bhangra music, Jazzy B. Yeah. He's the GOAT. This guy is amazing.
Yeah, he is. He is the man, you know. And
he is the man.
So that's quite interesting because he recorded his album there. But then obviously Jazzy then made the trip to the UK. Because he wanted to perform, and this is where the industry was, and this is where the live bands were. Yep. So he made that step, he took that sacrifice, you know, left his family and lived here, I think, alone for a while, just gigging. And and after that, so once his name was made here, he's off to India. And he is the greatest, I think, Punjabi wise. He's great.
Yeah, he's the epitome of working hard and staying the course and not giving up. Like, he's the perfect. That's why I respect him so much. It's not about liking his music or not. You know what I mean? Like, look at his journey. The guy was literally like living in Shinda's floor, probably, for all we know, right? Sleeping on the floor, whatever. And like you said, he gave up everything. His family. I mean, I think he used to work as like in the construction industry here, from what I remember, whatever, he was doing railing or framing. I don't know what it was. And look at him now. Like, he's one of the greatest ever. He's going to go down as one of the greatest.
Easily.
You know, because he took the chance, he practiced, and he worked his ass off. He's, you know, he this guy should be on your wall.
Yeah.
You know, like, the biggest problem in our culture and our community is we don't really have any superheroes.
Yeah.
Like Gore do. Yeah. You know what I mean? We don't.
No, we don't. Right? No.
Like, he is a superhero to me. Yeah. If you think about it. You know,
and me. And me. I get it. I get him. I think that graft he's put in. And look at him, man. He's the man. And you're absolutely right about our people don't like to elevate people to a level of superstardom. They do it from afar, but not too much. They don't want them to. I don't know what it's about people. You know, I think he's absolutely amazing. I think his story is fantastic. And like you, I don't necessarily need to like his latest release. If it's good, it's good. It's not about that for me. He is going to go down as one of the greatest. Yeah. He changed UK Bhangra as well. Because when he came over, I know he had that Canada style of dressing, which for us was like, what, this guy's ridiculous. what man wears dungarees, right? And and you know, our bands were still wearing glittery tops, sequin tops, and headbands. You know, and so he came along, new style, that hip hop style of dressing, and it was so new to us. And he came to the Dome. That's where he first sung, in the Dome in Birmingham, and I think it was the Bhangra Pop Award, something like that, and Amarjit Sidhu days, and
good days, man.
Yeah, and he came on stage and he sung a Mylock song, and I think the room just thought, who is this guy? Again, he just smashed it. Again, probably a bit like the way he was in the studio. He was great live as well, you know, and he could dance, and he was non-stop dancer, high energetic, and his voice, you know, it's just power. And I spoke to Tubbsy the other day, and he goes, Jazzy, he's got so much energy. And he goes, every performance, he puts his all in, 100%. And he goes, I always have to be on my A game. He goes, I can't rely on just being Tubbsy, and I've got a bit of a name, you know. He goes, I have to be on my A game, because also we've got Bill as well, Machine Gun Billy from 4x4. And, you know, powerhouses, you know. I mean, they want to play with him because they know he's fantastic. And yeah, he is a hero. You're absolutely right. We should treat him like a superhero. And
I agree. You know, I get laughed at. People, oh, you're just like, look at you. I mean, chucking Jazzy B. I go, bro, I mean, like,
why not?
He's Jazzy B. You know what I mean? Like, it's because of him, you know, a lot of people started singing, especially from here.
Yeah, yeah, you know? Yeah. I mean, a lot of singers from here. You got Gurjit Sidhu, JK.
Yeah.
Obviously influenced by his style and singing, you know. So he's done so much. I mean, I went to India around the time a few years back. It's got to be about five, six years ago. And my nephew was at a wedding. I went for a wedding. And my nephews were there. They're dancing. They were dancing like Jazzy B. They had that sort of, you know, that.
Yeah, the Jazzy swagger.
Yeah. And I was going, what are you doing? He goes, I'm dancing. I go, what? He goes, like Jazzy B. He goes, you know, they wanted their hair cut like him. And that guy did more for dungarees than anyone else, I think.
He's a trendsetter in India.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Yeah,
he's a trendsetter for his target audience, which is India. You know what I mean? Like, when he gets a new haircut, people out here, like all the students and stuff, Jade Punjab, they're doing the same haircut, and power to them. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like how many people can you say have that much influence?
Yeah.
Like, where you're going to get a haircut and they're going to copy, where you're going to, you know, buy a flashy t-shirt like he wears or whatever. And now he's into the gym thing. If you've seen him, like a lot of us, when we get to that age, where we start, you know, I mean, how many people is going to influence to go to the gym? It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
You know exactly. What? It's great. I mean, the guy, and he's so down to earth too.
Yeah.
You know, he's such a nice guy. You know, at the video shoot, and I got to meet him again after so long. You know, we couldn't really chat, but it's just nice. He's just like the same Jazzy I remember meeting, like, say, 10 years ago, 15 years ago.
Yeah, yeah. And it's great. And, you know, and you think he can't get any better, but he's a Liverpool supporter as well.
Yes. Very, very Liverpool.
I just wanted to catch your reaction.
You know what, man? Listen, it is what it is, bro. It is what it is. It is what it is.
I wanted to get Liverpool in our interview. Just because I'm an asshole, like.
Body cancel. Actually, yeah, cancel.
But so, you. I mean, your background's it's quite full on, and I didn't realize how much you had done as well. Because sometimes you would mention online or something, or I worked with them, but you're kind of low key about it. You're not one to sort of shout from the rooftops. I've just mastered this for this so and so, and this. I did for so-and-so.
Yeah, I mean, the only why I started doing it recently was because I really want people to hear my work. Not because I want the work. I want people to... How do I say this? I'll sound like a dick. I'm not saying what I do is right, right? But I've got over 30 years experience. My biggest beef with our music culture is quality. Not like, we've got great musicians, we've got great singers, and the UK always set the bar for quality of music finished. That's what I really miss about the UK. Like, your stuff that you guys used to bang out used to sound absolutely phenomenal. What I have a problem with is when shitty sounding music gets all the accolades. Like there's some stuff that gets released that should never have been released. Like if that came out of my camp or my label, I would have fired someone. You get what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. It's absolutely critical that we do top-notch quality stuff from like start to finish with the videos. I mean, we're bang on videos. We make great videos. Don't get me wrong. The art, the visual side of stuff. I mean, that's Punjabi culture is dancing and videos, right? Mm-hmm. At the end of the day. But like to get taken seriously by everybody in the world, we need to compete with everybody in the world. And it's not me saying I'm the best. It's like, there's no arrogance in here. It's just me trying to elevate the game. Because when you used to hear stuff like the crossover stuff that Rishi would produce, like with Do Point No, right? That got played on like mainstream radio. It was still done by Punjabis, but it sounded absolutely fucking killer. Agreed? You know what I mean? Like you could pump that anywhere. Yeah. But when you got someone like, you know, I'll pick on Diljit because he blocked me, right, on social media. I'll pick on Diljit when he releases banger songs, like classics, and they sound like shit and they're distorted. You got to give your head a shake. Like, I'm sorry. Like, it's ridiculous. You're telling me a man of that caliber who's a top tier A-list artist who's getting 100 grand, whatever, 200 grand per show, selling out, you know, stadiums everywhere around the world, this has a shit sounding single. It's absolutely ludicrous. And that's unacceptable, is my point. Like you cannot take that and be like, whatever, it's all good. And I used to argue with people like, oh, chalo, nobody cares. If that's the attitude, then what's the point? We should care. Right? Because when you got A&Rs from like, because I deal with like A&Rs from all over the place, from all over the world, when you got people saying, what the fuck is this? You know what I mean? Like, it's distorted. Like, what are you guys doing? You know what I mean? Like, you're never going to get a second look because if there's like, let me tell you something. A lot of my buddies don't know this. We used to take Punjabi artists and try to make it, you know, to get them to Punjab or to India. Like, for example, Singh is King. Mm-hmm. That was my buddies. That was us. Right? Mm-hmm. It's hard to sell something when it isn't done right, in the sense of like to where mainstream thinks it's done right. That's all I'm saying, right? Mm. Like Sidhu Musiala right now is the hottest artist in the game. Do we agree?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I mean, he should be doing collabs with everybody you can think of.
Yeah. Yeah.
Why aren't they? They've got the money, I'm pretty sure. Money's not the issue. Mm. Right? You know what I mean? Like, whatever the issues are, I think we have an opportunity. Because listen, at the end of the day, right, India's a billion people, right? It's a huge market. I can tell you when, you know, someone like David Guetta went out there, you know, a lot of these mainstream artists, they think India is a shithole, right? But when they actually go out there and you got 30,000 people at a show, they go back and tell everybody else, you know what, you need to go to India, right? Like when Snoop went out for Sing Is King, like he came back, he's like, holy shit, like that was nuts.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But all it takes is that one artist to go out there, have a bad experience. Like, don't go there, man. It's a shithole. It's game over.
Yeah.
That's why we have to continue to set the bar. It's really important because it's not about me whining and complaining, right? It's not. It's bigger than me. It's bigger than you and I. Mm. It's about actually being taken. Like, listen, man, K-pop. How big is K-pop? All these Korean bands.
Massive.
Yeah. They sound phenomenal. And they're on a small little island.
Yeah.
Right. And we like, so you can't, you know, like I'll give you an example. And this is what I tell everybody when people say India, this thing, I go, listen, man, India's got a billion people. Like we know, how come there hasn't been one Justin Bieber yet? Think about that. These are A&R labels from like the state saying, if you don't find them, we're going to find them and we're going to make a killing. Something to think about, right?
Yeah. I mean, it does take other industries to. I know they do that with football or soccer, as you guys wrongly say it.
I'm football
guy. Yeah, because they I think that in India they're looking for that Indian footballer because they know if they get one, and he's in the Premiership or you know Italian league or wherever you know in the Spanish league, they're gonna make a ton of money. You know, they get the right guy with the right branding, the right look. And if he can play, they know they're going to kill it because at the end of the day, it's business and they want to make money. Right. So, and you're right. Where's the singers? We've got a billion people out there. Where's that? Where's the Bieber? Yeah, I'm sure he's out there or she's out there. I'm sure.
Right. I mean, it just makes you think, right? Like the endless possibilities of what we can do as a culture musically. and actually make a career, like a, you know, like, you know, the top 4 or 5 DJs are making a career, the top, you know, whatever, 1% A-listers, Punjabi music. But how many stories you hear, like, of amateur hip hop artists that you never heard of, they're making 6 figures a year, enough to, you know, make a wage. Tons of them, because the way the structure is set up. My biggest thing with our music culture, there's no structure. It's like, we call it a Punjabi industry, but it's not really, man. It's just an association of like-minded people.
Yeah, it's just a group of people, right?
You know, which is fine. But I mean, you would hope that with this next, like the millennials, they'll, you know, coming out of school, they'll, you know, we'll have more entertainment lawyers, we'll have more real CEOs running, you know, music companies, maybe start to learn to set up things differently. You'd hope, right? I mean, that was a nice thing about the UK, when you know, like, I come back to Dope Point, the way it was set up structurally, it was really nice, and how the BBC set up with like their playlist A and playlist B. So UK's got the infrastructure already in place. I mean, we do here as well in Canada with SoCan, but you know, our biggest problem is, like, you know, we only have a limited number of artists, right? And the nice thing about here is if you're a Canadian artist, they have to play you right on radio. There's a certain criteria, right? So, you know, but you're hopeful. Like, I've always been optimistic. I mean, it may not happen in my lifetime, but, you know, maybe my girls, like, I encourage them, if they go into the arts, if they decide to, you know, make a change. Like, just don't be a guinea pig, you know, don't be a, someone just going to sit there and just like, yeah, you know, actually make a difference.
Do,
you know,
something,
change things. That's been my whole thing, is like, I get a lot of grief, man. Oh, you're always whining, you're always complaining. I'm like, I'm not doing it for my own sake. I don't need the clicks or the likes or you yelling at me. If I put anything out there, it's because I want someone to make an honest living out of music. You know what I mean? Like, if I could make an honest living, say being on radio, I would have been on radio, right? On something. But it just wasn't possible at the time. Like now, like, if you think about it this way, like when we started out, like being a DJ in the wedding scene, like UK was probably, you know, 10 years ahead of us, but here it was just a hobby. Like, I DJed weddings. It was like, you know, maybe $500 you make out of it, out of, you know, starting at like, you know, 3 PM, then get home at 3 AM. Like, was it really worth it? Probably not. But now, you know, we all laugh at big Asian weddings, but it's made a great economy.
Yeah.
Like, I got buddies that have like 4 or 5 setups a night and they're making bang. Like, they're doing over like 7 figures.
Yeah.
Like, who would have heard, you know, makeup artists making great money, hairdressers, buddy Tantwale killing it.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
You know, it's great to see. We have such a beautiful economy. It was, even though we laugh about the Asian weddings, we always make fun of it, but it's created such a beautiful economy within the culture.
Yeah, absolutely. You know? I mean, and that's, it's talked about within, like, with Gore and people that I know, they're always talking about Indian weddings. They're amazed about how they are. They asked me how many people at my wedding, and I got 350, 400, I can't remember. And they're just shocked, and they just can't believe it, you know. And but for us, it's normal. That's an Indian wedding, right? That's just the way it is, right? It's a 3, 4, 5 day event. And you know, yeah, it's cha-ching. All the alcohol's all free. And he goes, "What, you can drink?" I had some friends from work who came, and they were like, "What? Where's the bar?" And I go, "No, there's no bar. It's on your table. When you run out, you tell that bloke, and he'll get you another one." And they just couldn't believe it. But you're absolutely right. You know, and then small little cottage industries, you know, like makeup, and even the lads who dye Thai turbans now. You know,
I mean, it's great. You know what I mean? I'm like, Rishadar didn't even do it right. You know what I mean? Like, you're like, I mean, it's Satyanath.
Yeah, right? My brother-in-law tied mine, and I thought, that'll do.
Yeah, that'll do. But it's great. And you know what? And, you know, I'm a big, like yourself, I'm a big social media advocate, because it's the perfect place to get your brand out. Like me, I've shifted from, like, you know, kind of like the technical side of things, and I really focus on helping artists and brand themselves. I don't really advertise it, because I don't want, like, I'm so busy with other shit that I don't need the work. I only help, you know, certain people and certain friends. And it's like, you know, like, I see makeup artists, like, with like crazy YouTube views, just sitting there in front of a mirror, just doing their makeup. And I find it fascinating. Mm-hmm. And they, you know what I mean? They're getting like, you know, 100,000 like legit subs, and they, you know, they got their, you know, they're making a great side income out of that. It's fantastic to see.
There's actually, in 2015, I got shortlisted for the Asian Media Awards.
Yes.
And I actually, not just me, but in my group, I lost to a makeup artist.
Oh, no way. I was vouching for you, man.
Yeah. She won it. And I cannot forget. Remember her name now, so forgive me. I doubt she's listening to this, but she won. She had millions of views. I think she was tying a hijab or something. It was one of her tutorials, and it got millions of hits. And I think that was not a world I knew of, you know. And the second year, I got shortlisted again, and I lost to Jay Shetty. I remember
good company though, man.
Good company, and I remember looking in the brochure, and my name was with Jay Shetty. My wife goes, "You ain't gonna win."
Straight shooter, I like her.
Yeah, she goes, "She goes, I've seen his stuff." I've heard your stuff.
Oh wow!
But what the point being is, I have a love hate relationship with social media. I really enjoy this. I mean, me and you are doing this. I'm going to put it out on, iTunes and Spotify, and I'm going to share it on Facebook and Twitter and whatever, right? Instagram. Great. I've got a sort of a distribution network. You know, I can get people to view it. On the other hand, I hate all the nonsense. And
we're talking about on Twitter now?
Yeah.
You might as well segue right into it.
Beautifully, I've gone into that. And I've heard of Black Twitter. I've heard of that. And I know about that. But I didn't know there was a brown Twitter, right? And I've been following you. I've only got following about 80 people at the moment. So I got a new account, you see. I lost my old account. And
all right.
So I follow you. And I follow a few other Canadians, mainly because they know you, kind of thing, right? And
I'm honored.
And a few people in the UK, you know, Bhangra people, like Tubbsy GV and Dip Spammer, people like that, right? And it's been an eye-opener for me, honestly. The back and forths. I don't know about you, Herman, but I see the conversations ongoing and the debates about life and deep subjects. And I just think nothing's going to get resolved here. Why is anyone putting any effort into this conversation? Nothing's going to get solved here. And I know you're a big Twitter fan. You're on it a lot. I don't know if you're a fan.
It's my favorite social media platform, to be honest with you, because you can get your point across with certain characters. But you're absolutely right. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, I troll too. I talk a lot of trash on there.
Yeah.
I like to start conversations because they're important, because we don't do it. But when you're behind, like, we all laugh about keyboard warriors, you know what I mean? But there's also those that are afraid to say something in person that got an opportunity to speak out. Mm. Like, you know, like recently you've seen all this stuff that's happening with the CORE movement, which is really sad to see, you know, with all the sexual abuse of all these girls and stuff.
Yeah.
So that never would have happened if there wasn't social media.
With the CORE movement, that's probably something that the UK may not know about. Are they based in Canada?
I believe so. Yeah. North America somewhere. And, it's basically, you know, this one individual, I can't remember her name. She's brought it upon herself to kind of help any women that have been, sexual advances, sexual abuse, from sort of like the entertainment industry. That's what's kind of come across now. Like, for example, you know, video directors saying, "Hey, you know, come to my hotel room," or whatever, like singers. But I think it'll be beyond that. I think it'll be a one-stop shop for like any abuse, which is great.
Cause it's
tough, man, for like, listen, you know, I got two daughters, you know, I see the scary shit out there. At the end of the day, you can only do whatever you can to the best of your ability as a parent.
Mm.
And there's some things that she just will never be able to come to me for.
Mm.
Right. But, you know, like I joke and laugh. Like, I have a lot of female friends. And to be honest with you, the reason why I have these female friends is for my daughters.
Mm.
I'm being straight up. Like, you know, I'm happily married. I got my wife. You know, I'm a straight shooter. You've seen me on social media. I do have female friends. And it's because I want my daughters to be able to go to someone if they can't come to us.
Mm.
You know, someone they can trust. The biggest thing is trust. You know, if I trust him, then she can trust him. So, because it's important, man, because, you know, we're still that step behind culturally where we're kind of like faux pas to talk about our issues, you know, in the open. I think it's changing. Like, these millennials are fucking crazy. I mean, these guys are, you know, they're straight shooters.
Yeah, I would definitely agree with you, because I was talking about my interviews, they're long form interviews, and I found it difficult for some people to talk openly about all sorts of subjects. But then I had some younger guests on, a bit like Inquisitive, the artist.
Yep.
And
he's good guy, man. Amon.
Amon's a great guy. And I know he's come to Canada a lot, but he's kind of got that mentality about social media. He's open. He talks about a lot of things and he's open with his fans and he's very good on social media. And so when I interviewed him, he was an open, he's open, you know, anything was on the table and he was relaxed and he knew exactly what was going on. He knew what a podcast was, which always helps. Right? And I think you're right. The new generation, maybe because that's because of the kind of society we're in now where we share everything, you know, we share.
It's going to be a true test for them because we had our own tests. Because remember, we grew up in an environment where we were on that, if you think of a bridge, we had our parents here, very desi, mine were, and you have Western culture. We were right in the middle, right? And me, you and I sat on the last generation where, the first generation where we actually teach our parents versus they were taught by their parents. Mm. You get what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Like nothing was passed on to some of us maybe, but like farming was never passed on to generation to me. Mm. Whatever wasn't passed on, we did our own thing. So there's a conflict there because I know when I see with my dad, it's like there's some stuff that he wants me to do, but I know I can do it better. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I still have to kind of give him that treatment where, you know, he's the man.
Yeah.
You get what I'm saying?
Yeah. Yeah.
So it was a different struggle for us. Mm. These kids now, like my daughters can do whatever they want as long as they're happy. Mm. I don't care. As long as they, you know, obviously follow the rules, you know, don't do anything stupid, you know, whatever. Mm-hmm. Right. Do what you want.
Be safe and, you know,
be safe, yeah, you know, yeah, be happy. Don't break the law, you know, do what you want and kulishuktina, just be happy. Right. So they got a tougher test because this generation's still here. Right. Then you got us that, you know, we pretend like, oh, you know, we're born and bred in the UK, whatever. We still have that tie to the old school.
Yeah.
You know, I know I do.
Yeah. We can be desi. Right? So, we can be very desi. Yeah.
They're getting attacked by two generations. So this is a true test for them. So I think they have a tougher thing. And that's why I think avenues like this where they still respect us and they got social media to, you know, as much as I don't like people hiding behind profiles, but you know, I've seen messages from like Jyoti K, she's a friend of mine, and she'll send me these messages of all these girls like messaging her saying, I can't give you my name, but this is what's happened to me, you know, blah, blah, blah. And I read it and I'm like, holy shit, dude. Like we never had that. We could not go to anybody.
Mm-hmm.
Like we couldn't even go to our school teacher. Because at that time you're like, oh, just go home. Don't worry about it. That's how shit works. You know what I mean? There's a different mentality.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, when we talk about brown Twitter, it's got its, you know, it's got its good and bad. Like you said, you know, you read some of the shit on there, like, people like, you know, work at like, you know, Tesco, you know, giving medical advice.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Like what?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like it just, you know, and then you see the string back, but you shake your head, you know, it's just like, what are you guys doing? You know what I mean? Like, I understand it's a free for all. You can go out there, say whatever you want, but everything you put out, there's a consequence.
Yeah.
Like everything you put out.
I think I laugh about brown Twitter and I'm on Twitter and I'm brown. So I'm probably part of it. Right. But I think I get annoyed, not just with brown Twitter, but Twitter and social media in general, when people try and debate quite serious subjects. And for me, it's annoying because I prefer some action. I like, you know, so like the core movement, they've obviously done something. They've created something that's going to help someone. It's tangible. People can contact them. They can give them help. That's what I'm about. I think that's fantastic. It's the it's just nonstop conversations and going around in circles and I don't know. Maybe I'm getting older, man. I'm just getting annoyed. I'm an old man now. I'm getting, you know.
We're old and crabby, bro.
Oh, that's what I think it is. I'm just getting crabby and thinking, you know, these are serious issues here. And I'm glad, you know, your friend, that girls feel comfortable enough to talk to her and send her messages. I mean, that's something at least. You're absolutely right. It's something. And, you know, I know people say, well, why don't they go to the police? I mean, you know how hard it must be to go to the police if you've been in that situation and you've got no one to turn to and you probably feel ashamed, scared, and people go to the police. They haven't nicked your car. This is a lot this is something that's a lot worse than that, you know. And I just think it's very easy for people, and that's what annoys me. People on Twitter go, "Well, go to the police, go to the police, tell your parents, do this." You know, for a victim, I just don't think it's that easy, and I think it's harder than that.
It's not, bro. Because I mean, we don't make it easy either. Let me, like, you know, I got no beef with anybody, like, but I say that as is, right? Like, you take, like, you know, these guys that are abusing women, like these video directors or whatever, like the Dilpre Drillins, these Sooks and Garrows, they're allegedly, I'm saying allegedly, doing this stuff. Nothing's mm-hmm. been proven in court yet. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, nothing's going to happen to them. Mm-hmm. The industry's still going to, they're still going to get their songs out. Mm-hmm. These guys are still going to make the videos. I don't think not anyone has condemned them, like any of the heavy hitters. So as a person going through this, why would you want to go to someone? Because you're thinking to yourself, man, what's the point? Like, how can that be on your mental health? Like, I can't imagine, bro. Like, you know what I mean? Like, there's only certain Jyoti Ks in the world where she's going to come at you and basically tell you to go, you know, go fuck off, right? Like, those are rare, right? And it's not fair on her either to be the voice for all these women because, like, she's going to get attacked. You know, power to her. But at the end of the day, like, you know what I mean? It's tough, you know, like I can vouch. Cause I've been in situations like, listen, we've all go through some shit. I've been through my own shit and I got pro help. I'm not scared to admit it. And I'm a better person since then, but I took the initiative. Like, no one forced me to, but like people, like the step that I've done is rare for people. You know what I mean? Like the only time is when you take these steps, when you hit rock bottom. And I never wish these girls or these guys, whatever they're going through, ever hit rock bottom. You know what I mean? Like, I get messages all the time. It's funny. We talk about my podcast. I used to just like go on there, just talk about relationships, just my thoughts. Like, listen, we're both old cats. We're married for a long time. We got history, man. We know how shit works.
Yeah.
Right. We're not relationship experts, but we know expertly how to run our relationship. Right. And those are my most popular episodes.
Yeah.
And I still get DMs today. Hey, I'm having an issue with my boyfriend, this and that. And I'm like, listen, but I go, I'm not here to tell you what to do. But this is what I would do, right? And I'd be shocked at how many people are like, you know what, this really helped, you know me. And I'll get these encouraging messages, like, holy shit, you know, like actually help someone. Or like, I get a lot of stuff about music, obviously, right? You know, listen to my beat, listen to this, listen to that. And I you know, you got to give back, and I try to do whatever I can, but not everybody is helpable. Not everybody wants the help, right? Yeah. And that's a lot of people that people don't understand on brown Twitter. It's
not,
like,
not, you know, not everybody wants the truth either. So
no, they don't. They don't.
They want you to say, yeah, yeah, it's good. It's good. That's what they want. It's an ego boost. They don't really want your help. Yeah. It's more about, I mean, if I was to send you something saying, look, listen to my show, what do you think? And you said, actually, this is bad. The intro is not good. You're peaking at certain areas, blah, 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 blah. You gain too much on your mic. I think, fuck you, woman.
Prick.
Yeah. Just say it's good, man. I was proud of that show.
and you know, but that's what I'm saying, right? Like, because we you know, I don't like saying this because I love Punjabi. I'm a proud Punjabi. I love my culture, but every culture's got its good and bad, right? Like, our biggest problem is we have this facade that everything is perfect. Like, just sing and you become a famous singer. It's so easy. You know what I mean? Gaana gaala, don't worry. Asi kardange ho jana. Like, it's the biggest bullshit selling feature of the culture that I can't stand. Nothing's fucking easy, bro. You know what I mean? That's the thing I don't stand. Like, and chalo, we're Monday, right? But imagine how much harder it must be for girls. Like, I don't want to make this into a girl versus guy thing. But like, when you look at like someone like Miss Pooja, who's broken records, like, she is like, I have so much respect for her. I don't like half her music, right? I don't. Right. But it doesn't matter what she's done for the music culture. No guy has done. If you think about it, like, she's made like careers for men just for being on their songs. What does that tell you? Right. Give me a duet where a man's actually made a woman career. I can't think of anybody. Like, she made, like, you know, the you know, Jita Jaildars and whatever. Like, it was because of her. Right. But how much props does she get really in the scene? I don't know. It's a general question. Yeah. Like, you know, it's remarkable to see. So, you know, we got a lot of growing up to do. That's where I see brown Twitter. We got a lot of soul searching to do. You know what I mean? Like, we're so I think what I find is, like, when we're talking about the bridges, like, I find, like, this, like, we've broken the barrier. Like, we were confused as kids. Are we Punjabi? Are we UK? What do we do? Roti Khaniya, Sasi Gabalonia. Like, what do we do, right? We've broken that, and we've given a playing field for, like, my kids that you be you, right? So they're trying to rediscover what their Punjabi is, what their culture is, what Sikhi is. So when I see debates of, like, young people talking about, like, 1984 and this and that, I find it very interesting. You know what I mean? Like, I was there in 84, so I know exactly what went on, right? Something I'm not, you know, I don't like talking about. But when you see someone, like, who's born, like, 96, talking about how things should be, you're just like, well, hold on here, right? You know what I mean? But then you look back, you're like, okay, I see where they're coming from. They're trying to discover what Sikhi means to them. So as much as I try not to hate, you got to also look at the flip side. Like, they don't know. They need to discover their own way, right? But, you know, but some things, like, you know, you see, like, we shake our heads on brown Twitter. We message each other all the time. And it's just like, yeah, I don't know where that came from, man. It's totally out of order, but it is what it is. Yeah, you know, and it's we're in a weird, like, Punjabi culture is, like, in this weird holding pattern. It's like a rediscovery for, like, the millennials. You know what I mean? Like, it's really hard to, I don't know how to explain it.
Yeah. I don't know whether I just live in a bubble myself here. And I sometimes see some messages and or tweets and not from you guys, by the way, not anyone that I follow, but just from some random people. And I think, God, you must be such a sad person. Why have you made so much effort to be horrible to someone?
Yeah.
And, you know, or to send a horrible email. I mean, email takes a bit of work these days. You know, you have to log into your Gmail account and type, you know.
I get them all the time, man. People and you just creating accounts to email me.
That's even worse. It takes longer. Yeah. You have to create an account, you know, find a new password, and then to send off something nasty and malicious, even if you don't like someone's work or you don't, they're outspoken about something. What possesses you to write an email? Jesus, you know, come on. And I just feel sorry for them. I feel sad for them.
I do. It's like a deeper anger. Like this, like I follow British politics. Like, I have no say in your country. Don't get me wrong. I would never say, oh, yeah, you go vote for this guy. But, you know, I still have that tie, right? So there's that, what is it? That Aman Pogal, who's a conservative, Singh, just announced.
Well, yeah.
This guy got hated on. And I was like, holy shit, man. Like, parties aside, whatever, like, you know, how could you be a Sikh and go for this party? And I'm just reading some of the comments, and I'm just like, from the culture, I'm just like, holy fuck, this is wild. Yeah. You know what I mean? I get it, but I don't at the same time. It's
a strange one, because I mean, when me and you were young, do you remember the left were always seen as kind of the hippies, and it used to be against the, you know, the environment and Greenpeace, you know, and it was things like that, you know, and that's what the left was to us, you know. But the left now have gone so far left, they've gone nuts. So they're all for free speech. And but then if you say something that they don't agree with,
it's game over.
They're going to cancel you out, because they're trying to cancel J.K. Rowling at the moment, right? And
cancel culture, bro, it's a thing.
Yeah, this is what I wanted to ask you about. And lady, it's Jada, isn't it? Will's wife. They want to cancel her. But then I think, what do you mean cancel her? You can't wipe her off the earth. She's going to still be alive. You know, she probably doesn't give a shit what you think, you know.
probably not.
Yeah, she doesn't care, you know. And I mean, she doesn't care what Will thinks, really, does she, at the moment? So, but... But this cancel culture, you got to cancel people out, you know. It's such an odd one to me, you know, because you could pile on people that are completely innocent. This is my worry. So you could find someone who said something maybe, you know, 10, 15 years ago at some point, you know, as a joke, and they could just turn on them to say, you know, that's what you think now. I don't know about you. I'm not the same person I was last month.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. The biggest problem with social media is now you're guilty before proven innocent. Like, the social media jury, the public is the jury, you know, and they're the executioner.
Yeah.
And, you know, like, for example, I used to, you know, like, I have a thing where, you know, I'll tweet something and I worded it wrong and I'll delete it and I'll retweet it. And I'm like, oh, you delete your original tweet. You're a dick. And I'm like, Why? Because I wanted to reword it. You know what I mean? I get it all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
I was like, you know what? Like, I have no time for this BS. Like, I didn't change my point view or, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
Like, it's just me. Like, I can't type on these goddamn things, man. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, I always
got fat fingers. Yeah.
And I'm like, delete it. Or I like when you speak in your phone.
Yeah.
Right. I try to do that and it just says some dumb word and you don't even read it properly. And then you hit send, you're like, oh shit. And then you go back and you delete it and you type it in again. By the time before you type, oh, you already deleted it. I got it right here. I'm like, yeah, well, keep it. Put it on your wall, man. Manuki. I don't
yeah.
care.
Yeah.
Right. It's an odd one. It's given the problem with social media is it's given the authority to people that have no authority being the authority. Right? Mm-hmm. Like it'd be like me, you know, talking about brain surgery, like I'm the brain surgeon. Well, I'm not. Mm-hmm. You know, I know my lane, I stay in it. Yeah, I talk about general shit, which I feel, mm-hmm. which is just an opinion. Right. But you know, I would never, you know, sit there and be like, oh, you know, you did your brain surgery wrong and this is the way it should be, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know that what I mean? Like, and it's just like the same topics too with Brown Twitter.
Yeah,
like the same ones, you know, like sick versus non-sick, money versus sarda, jart non-jart, like, you know what I mean? It's just like
the jart one always makes me laugh. That one's always cracks me up because someone will say,
I don't know why they're getting hate on. Like all my buddies, you know.
Yeah.
Like, listen, I'm not a caste guy, but power to you, right?
Yeah.
I couldn't care less. Like my jart friends, I love them to death, right? I mean, like. Like I'm not like I don't consider myself a caste guy. So what you know you jarts do is not like it doesn't affect me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I don't know why it bothers people.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? But, I mean, whatever.
I'm always interested in the guys and girls who would put on their Twitter profiles Jetty or Jack.
Yeah.
They're very proud, right? And it always sort of makes me laugh. I'm a judge, but I don't think I'll put it on my bio anywhere.
Fair enough, right? Tell
people. But I don't begrudge them for putting it on theirs. And it's usually another person says, there's an issue against judge people, right? And they think they're arrogant or something. There's a, you know, I don't know what it is. It's one thing that makes me chuckle more than anything, that one.
It does. And you know what? I'll be honest. Like, from the outside looking in, I think, you know, there's plenty of PR jarts could do to be honest with you, but at the same time it's a proud culture
and
so be it, you know. If you're proud to be jarred, then be proud. I don't care.
We got some good songs.
Yeah, man, you guys got bangers, right? I've played them at parties. And there's nothing wrong with that. It's just, you know, I think, you know, when we come to cast in general, it's when one cast thinks they're better than the other, or the implicit sort of, you know, that implicit racism of like rank, which we do see and is quite common. Like, we can say whatever we want, we can hide it, but it's there. I've seen it, I've witnessed it. You know what I mean?
Mm.
And that's a problem. Like, be proud, but you know, we're all on the same playing field. Like, if you want to, you know, we're not, you know, no one's doing what they're supposed to be doing if you think you're a caste, right? You know what I mean? Like, everyone's doing odd things here and there. But
it was interesting with the Black Lives Matter, and I saw a lot of posts from Upperney and, you know, Black Lives Matter, which is good. And
I was quite vocal about it too.
Yeah. And but some of the people I saw, I know they're racist. I know they are, right? they're just getting clout. I know. And I thought they want likes. Yeah, they want likes. You know,
really?
That's bad. Mate, yeah, yeah, you know,
that's so, an important movement, man.
I think,
like,
it is an important movement, but I think we should look at our own house first as well.
I agree,
yeah,
but we're in denial. We won't look at our own house.
No, we won't.
We're in denial. This is the problem, right? Like, but this could be a stepping stone, you know what I mean? Like, I was vocal about this, like, a while, like, you go to the protests, which I've attended. And there was a very, very weak, sick Punjabi, whatever. Mm. You know, I didn't see that many. And we've been through some shit as a culture.
Mm.
You know what? We still go through some shit, right? And the wounds are still fresh, especially those that have been there in 84. Like, I don't want to make this into about 84. But you know what? I was there because of me and what happened to us. but at the same time, being able to reflect through a movement. It wasn't about us. It was about being there for the people that need us the most. Like, listen, at the end of the day, right? You know what? Yeah, all lives matter. That's a given. But right now, Black lives have the mic, right? And they deserve the mic. They have the mic. Let them have their turn, and, right? Because we help fix, you know, this. It helps everybody. Maybe not India or whatever, but I mean, whatever. I mean, that's a different, India's a different can on its own, right? You know, the rules are different, regulations are different, people run the country are different. But here, if you're living in North America or in the UK, you got an opportunity to make some beautiful needed changes, right? And it just saddens me that we're not a big part of it when we should be, because man, I was there in the 80s in the UK when the riots happened in Southall. I was there, right? It was a shit show, right? We all stood in solidarity, and we should have been there now too, right?
I think even more so, because the generation me, you, and from, you know, second generation, we owe a lot to Black culture.
We do.
You know, musically, artistically, the clothes we wear, I mean, especially musically, you know, even Bhangra music, and, you know, a lot of the influences from Black music, and we owe them more than a tip of the hat, you know, we owe them a lot of gratitude, and you're right, we should really be there for them. But I think with Upper people, the moment something like that comes, it's always about, well, what about us, you know, they're going to start bringing up their issues, and, you know, it's always the same thing, you know.
Yeah.
It became about us, didn't it? It became a selfish thing again.
And I've seen it. It's like, oh, if you know, if you're like, for example, it's like, oh, because it happened kind of at the anniversary of, like, you know, what happened in 1984 in June, right? And it's like, oh, if you're all for Black Lives Matter and you're not tweeting about, you know, this, then you're a douchebag. And you're just like, you're missing the point, right? Mm-hmm. Like, no one's saying that's not less important or not important at all. Right now, they have the mic. Right now, there's protests right now in your city where Black people need help, mm-hmm. right? Like, sure, we got our problems, but you know what? We got it pretty easy. Like, we don't get racially profiled as bad as Black people do. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, we're pretty safe to go to a walk to the pub or whatever without a cop really, you know, being a dick. Mm-hmm. Right at the end of the day, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? So, you know, as a culture, we're, you know, as a Sikh, we're supposed to help the oppressed. Mm-hmm. Yes? Mm-hmm. Right? It's one of our duties. Well, we're, you know, we're, you know, the golden opportunity. Right. I think we would have killed a bunch of, you know, birds with like one stone personally, but it is what it is. And when you talk to people like that, it's just, we're so angry, bro. Like, you can't have intelligent conversations. That's the other thing I find. It's like, you know, especially because those wounds are still fresh. Like, they're, it's from the heart, but I understand that, but like, you got to have intelligent conversations if you want things to change. You can't sit there, go guns blazing, and start yelling and screaming because no one's going to listen.
Yeah, no, I think that's where my issue is. And I think there's not them intelligent conversations. And the only thing I worry about, you know, like with Black Lives Matter, not with them, but we need that structural change, because I remember, you know, the LA riots with Rodney King, and
yep.
Have things moved on since then? Obviously not. We're in the same situation as we was then, you know, and you just think we haven't moved forward at all, you know. I don't know, you know, there's terms like white privilege and gammon. Have you heard of gammon?
No.
That's one they use in the UK for, you know,
okay.
The white blokes mainly who go on about Brexit, or, you know, sort of right-wing white men who... may have tones of racism in them or whatever, right? So we call them gammon. And I don't know how these structures will change, you know, and how we'll move forward, because we don't, you know, you got young kids, I've got young kids. Do we want another 10, 15, 20 years and it happens again and nothing's moved on? We're still in the same situation as we was then.
You know what? You can't teach an old dog new tricks. The problem with racism, it's passed on from generation to generation. We've got our own. Like, listen, cash shit's racist. You can say whichever, you can be proud to be whatever you want. They're still racist at the end of the day. Like I said, I love my Jut friends, but you're racist as fuck. right? You know what I mean? I'm too. Right. If you want to talk like caste, we're gonna, you know, like when you say something, I'll clap back. Right. You know what I mean? Like I just get in the conversation, like, tenuki, you know what I mean? Like, you know, like it's just dumb shit. But the only, like, this is where hip hop is so cool because they've created an economy and a whole culture that now the world, like hip hop music is the number one listening music in the world right now. It surpassed rock. So changes are coming. It's because they took 20 years to get to this point, right? They've got their own food, their own culture, their own music. They got their own CEOs. They got their own businesses, right? And the key thing is they own their own mainstream radio. They own their own mainstream TV. Like I'm talking proper mainstream, not some 2 kilometer radio shit, right? They're getting stuff out to the masses and they're doing stuff for their people. I mean, we're great at doing stuff for our people, but it's the administration of it to the masses that I have the message, right? Like the problem is the blurred lines. Like if we look at hip hop, there rarely is a religion aspect to it. Do you agree?
100%. Yeah, there isn't.
Right.
No,
it's the culture.
Yeah.
We have blurred lines between culture and religion.
Yeah.
You know, they're like, there's no caste in Sikhi. Yeah. Well, yeah, I get that. Right. And then, you know, like there's blurred lines. So I think, like I said, we got a lot of growing up to do. We got a lot of soul searching to do, you know, and we're between you and me, bro. Like we're past that point. Like, you're not going to be 50 in 5 years. You know what I mean? Like, I really don't give a shit anymore. You know, I've done everything I possibly want to do. I just got to be the best father, you know, the best husband I possibly can to my family. And hopefully they learn and they do whatever.
Yeah.
At the same time, like I'm not teaching them, you know,
no,
you're this, you're that, or jot this, jot. Like I'm not teaching them shit like that. Right. Cause I figured it out early enough that that's not what we're about.
I think you're absolutely right. That there is blurred lines between the religion and culture, and it's always been like that. It's always been, but I think it's gone to another level now. What with social media as well, it's given it fresh impetus, and it never used to be like that. I remember in the past, it was quite interesting. Actually, I was, you know, I mentioned Tubbsy again. He said they used to perform in the Godware early on, and then he goes, that was a stage for youngsters to kind of go up and to play. So the band would play at the Godwara and also play at the hall. So he goes back in the day, right? And
I remember that.
And so he goes, that was kind of an opportunity for youngsters to learn instruments and to have a stage, a start, you know. And he goes, that's all gone now. And he goes, that was quite integral part to why, you know, people like Sadara, I know, and he used to sing in the Godwara as well, you know, Galwant Bambara, and they become up on Asangeet and a Bajangi group, and they all started from the Godwara, you know, playing there. He goes, but could you imagine that now? Could you imagine artists? I don't know what it's like in Canada, but in the UK, I couldn't imagine any type of Bhangra band playing in the Godwara, even if they're doing Dharma Geet or anything like that, you know. I don't think that would happen.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, I'm going to get blasted for this, but, you know, I didn't want to make it about the religion, but it's one of the, like, we grew up where we were told to go to the Gurdwara and we went, you know, deep inside when I think about it, I did, you know, there's days where I didn't want to go, but I still wanted to go. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I got my music roots from the Gurdwara, but times have changed, you know, like if my girl doesn't want to go, she doesn't want to go. You can't force them, you know? And I always flip back. It's like, well, you know, the culture and the religion also has to promote, you know, not recruit, promote, right? Are they doing that? I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And, but then you got, you know, we don't need to do shit. You know, Sikhi needs to be in you. Yeah, I get that. But how are you going to tell that to a 7-year-old kid that's born and raised here that listens to, you know, Drake all day?
And watching YouTube, you know.
Watching YouTube, you know, like, you know, there's no real, you know, like, you know, I'm glad like there's that, you know, that there's some animated films about Sikhi that came out, which my kids watched and enjoyed. But, you know, stuff like we can't have an actor play any, you know, gurus to make film. And I get why they've done that. But at the same time, wouldn't it be cool? Right? Mm-hmm. Like, I'm not saying we should do this. I'm just saying, what if? Right? It'd be cool to see a full feature film of like Guru Gobind's journey, like all the cool stuff he's done. It'd be cool to see, right? Mm. Versus an animated film.
Yeah.
But we don't do that sort of stuff. And I'm not saying that's good or bad, but I think there's elements of stuff that we could do to kind of, promote. I'm trying to stay politically correct here, because I don't want to get slaughtered, man, because this is a tough conversation. And like I said, people get really heated about this, and
they do. I mean, I understand what you're saying, but it's also about our culture as well. You know, we're sometimes pulled in about four directions, I think. You know, we're pulled in from our culture, from our parents, who are kind of traditional, but they want us to be more Canadian or English, and, you know, to get them kind of jobs like doctors and engineers or whatever. Mm-hmm. We've also got the music and arts side that we enjoy. It may not be Punjabi. It could be like you, hip hop and R&B or whatever it is, right? And then got the other side where we enjoy the Punjabi songs at weddings. We like talking a bit of English Punjabi with our mates, you know, and so we enjoy that side as well. And then we've got religion as well, which is obviously a fundamental part of us, right? Not just Punjabi people, but, you know, Gujaratis, Hindus, Muslims, they've got that as well. And so it pulls in all sorts of different directions. And then you sometimes wonder, of course, we're slightly confused on who we are.
Of course.
Who wouldn't be? You know, exactly. You know, we don't live in a world where it's black and white. This is who you are. This is what you do. This is what you need to do. You can't do that. And you can do that. You know, that'd be a lot easier. So I think you're right. For our younger generation, for like my daughters, who are 7 and 5 now, they might be in quite a tough world for them, I think, emotionally, and how they're going to sort of navigate these kind of questions for themselves. You know, who are we? You know, I talk to my kids. She's only 5, and she thinks my mum, her grandma's Punjabi, but she isn't. And I said, no, you're Punjabi as well. She goes, I'm not. She goes, grandma is, I'm not Punjabi. And I try to explain to her, look, you're Punjabi as well. You know, it's that kind of conversation where they don't make the connection yet.
But I mean, and I'm not here to insult anyone, and she's kind of correct, right? Like, she's a British born child in a Punjabi family.
Mm.
At the end of the day, like, let's be real here.
Mm.
I'm a Canadian born,
but
I'm born in a Punjabi family. I'm born in this country. I am Canadian. My passport's Canadian. I am Canadian. Right? At the end of the day, I'm assuming you're born in the UK.
No, actually, I was born in Punjab.
Okay, so you're a Punjabi born in a, you know,
born in Indian, the bend,
born in a yeah,
born but in the bend. So you're, went to another bend called Gravesend, and then and this is where I am. But for my kids, you're right. I know what you mean. I know your point.
And the problem is, there's nothing wrong with that. Like, I get so much people like, oh, you know, you're Punjabi. I'll go outside. No, I'm Canadian.
Right.
Okay. I got Punjabi, but I'm Canadian. They're like, no, you're not. You're Punjabi. I go, no, bro, I'm Canadian. And I'm proud to be Canadian. That's the thing that people don't get. Like, I'm very fortunate to be born in this country. Right. And there's nothing wrong with that. And then some people are okay with it. Some people are not. But it's funny. Then you see, like, people that are born in India saying they're Punjabi. So they're Indians born in a Punjabi family. Right.
Because
we don't have our own state or country. We have our own state. We don't have our own country. That's a fact. Right. I don't agree with it. But it is what it is. But you see Punjabis shitting on Indians that are proud to be Indian, but have to be Punjabi.
Yeah.
Right? Like, listen, I know you, Sai. You're UK, really, at the end of the day, even though you're born. But you're proud of where you are. You're proud. You wear your Union Jack when you need to. I put on my Canadian shit when I need to. Right, when we're big hockey fans here, when Canada's in the Olympics, man, there's nothing wrong with that. Right? You know, because I got my heart in the UK, when the UK plays India and anything, I'm supporting the UK. That's my second home.
Yeah, with the football, it's England when I watch the World Cup.
Yeah, me too.
I don't think twice about any other country, and I don't want them to lose. I know some people that want them to lose, don't they? You know,
but my point is it's okay. Like, it doesn't make me less Punjabi than the next person per se. You know what? And these are, like, I tell my daughters, I go, yeah, you are Canadian born girls, but you are born in a Punjabi family. Yes, you are Punjabi, right? But you're, you know, that's your culture, but you're Canadian. You know what I mean? Mm. And I think that's where, when we were growing up, like, we were so confused, like, what the fuck am I?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like,
definitely. Yeah.
What do we need to be? Right. But we have an opportunity to teach our kids, like, listen, you are proud UK citizen. You have every right that every other, you know, person has in this country, born in this country. Mm. But you also have, you know, that special privilege of being born into a Punjabi family, where now you can learn your roots of where your culture comes from. Mm. Whether or not they decide to take those roots and how much to take of it, that's not for us to decide, bro. Mm-hmm. That's for them to decide. Mm. You know what I mean? Like, my girls wanted to learn Punjabi in school, and while they had it, they took it and they really enjoyed it. Mm. If they turn around and said to me, I don't want to take it anymore, I'll be like, okay, what am I going to do? Force them to go there? Mm-hmm. Right? You can't do that. You know what I mean? Like, you know, if my girl decides that she doesn't want to be attached to the culture, you know, God forbid that doesn't happen, that's on her. Mm. Right? And I probably failed as a parent. Mm. Right? Mm. But it, you know, I, like I said, we got a lot of soul searching to do. I think once we figure that out, that it's okay to be a proud Canadian or proud UK citizen and be proud to be born into a Punjabi family, that's when I think things are going to change, mm-hmm. in my opinion. Because mm-hmm. right now we're so confused. It's like, I go to, like, these cricket games in the UK, and it's like these British born people are, like, you know, got the India stuff on, cheering for India. Nothing wrong with that. Yeah, Nothing wrong with that. But you're just like, okay, right? You know what I mean? Yeah. But it's also a shake your head moment. It's weird to me, because I guess, you know, like, I think differently. Like, I'm born in this country and I'm proud of it. Mm. You know, but, you know, like, but I have to give the UK credit. It's, you lot were the first to be proud UK Brit Asians. When anytime England played, you'd have your Union Jacks on, Union Jack bugs on, right? That was new here. It was only till, like, when the Olympics came or something, big event, I could see, like, Apne, you know, be proud to wear Canadian jerseys and stuff. So it's like a time thing, right? And it was really cool to see, because if you think about it, it's reverse racism if you do it the other way.
Yeah.
Honestly, if you think about it.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Like, I'm not here to pick on anyone. I'm not here to say you're right or wrong. I'm just telling you from where, the way I see things and from my experiences, because it's, you know, years of sitting here. Like, I used to do Bhangra just like you did, bro. Mm-hmm. I did for many years, bar club in Richmond. That was my roots to the Punjabi culture, was through music and dancing. Mm-hmm. We used to do Bhangra to fight racism. Mm-hmm. I can tell you, went to a native reserve. Okay. We got a lot of indigenous people here. Mm. Went to Native Reserve. Before we got on stage, they're throwing gachdi and botaladas. Get these fucking packies off the stage. Yeah, we were kids, shit scared. Uncle goes, no, karna fana. We got on, killed it. We went back on 3 times. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
We were now initiated into the country, basically. Like, these are the people that ran the country, owned the country. That was theirs. It's like, you guys are awesome Canadians. And it felt really good, even though we're Punjabi descent, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, these, I wish we had conversations like these. Like, it's almost like there's, like, an identity crisis.
Oh, definitely. I don't think almost. There is definitely one. And I think a lot of people are worried to say what they actually feel. I think there is a lot of people that actually feel, you know what, I do feel British. I speak English way more than I speak Punjabi because I'm at work most of the time, and my friends are English as well. And I like going to the pub with them. I like going to the bar with them after work for a few drinks. I like going to restaurants with them. I love that cultural aspect of being British or Canadian, you know. But I also like being Punjabi, and I like being, you know, I like being with my family, and I like Punjabi food. So I don't think there's nothing wrong in having both. But just be proud. You can be proud of both. You don't need to put one down for the other. Because you can get the other side as well, where people are so they become so English that they don't want to talk about being Punjabi, and they don't want to speak Punjabi, and they kind of, you know, they want to have their English friends, and, you know, they kind of distance themselves. So you can get both sides of the coin here, yep. You know?
Yeah.
I think people 100%. Should just, man. I think people should just be who they are and be happy and be confident in what they are. And, but you're right. I think there is an issue with identity. And I'm hoping our kids, when they grow up, they won't have that. And they're quite confident in who they are and where their place is in the world.
You know what? The Punjabi culture, what we saw, is not going to be the same. It's slowly dying, bro. Let's be real here. You know, people like, especially the spora, everyone outside, are still holding on to something that just doesn't exist. It doesn't. You know, we've made a good life out here. We got a lot of Punjabis here. It's just India, right? You know, still a deep-rooted connection. But when you go back to India, it's nothing like how it was 20 years ago. Not even close, right? You go to Punjab, everyone speaks Hindi there. You know what I mean? And it is what it is. And, you know, we grew up here, born and raised here. Like with me, especially, hip-hop is a huge part of my culture. Because, it made me a career.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But at the same time, I understand where my ties are to the culture, but that came through experiences, meeting other Punjabis, you know, life experiences, you know, being forced to go to Gurdwara, go to, you know, this house, roti khanu, this and that, right? Like it was a totally different lifestyle. And, you know, it's, people are holding on to this pipe dream that,
you know, it's that not gonna happen.
Punjabi culture is, it is what it is. And I just don't see it personally. Like I see it slowly, slowly dying. I do. And, you know, it's sad. That's why I keep saying, like, we got to document our shit. We got to document our shit. Like, you know, like how many, bro, there's a guy, Retro Pangra, that I follow on Facebook and on Twitter. And this guy has posted, like, I'm a music head, Punjabi music head. He's posted bands from the 80s I've never heard of. Bhangra bands. Never heard of.
Yeah.
And I'm like, holy shit. Like, I actually tweeted this. I go, I'm so shocked how many bands were in the UK in the 80s.
Oh, yeah.
Must have been 50 of them.
Yeah.
In the 80s.
Yeah.
Versus how many are actually active now.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And if we don't document that, the culture is never going to grow. You know what I mean? It's really important we do that.
I mean, it's such a vibrant scene. I mean, that music, that Bhangra scene was so vibrant, what, 70s, 80s. I mean,
good days, man.
You know, the 90s, the early 2000s. I mean, it was the peak, you know, and India would look at the UK for ideas on music and steal them, basically. And so it was the hub of music for a long, long time, you know. And it was such a vibe. You remember as well when you used to go to weddings and you would think, what band is it going to be? What band? And it always used to be a top tier band, right? It could be Sahotas. It could be Apna Sangeet, DCS.
You walk in, you see what's on the drum because they'd have their label on it. Oh, it's DCS today. Yeah. DCS.
and if it had massive speakers, you knew it was Azhar because they had the massive rig. Yeah. They had the biggest speakers known to man, right? And it was great. You know, it was amazing, you know, when you see these people. And but I don't think that scene's going to come back. I don't think it will now. I don't think people have got the patience to learn these instruments even, you know, to put that time and effort into rehearsals. You know, you got to practice. No, you know, so that's why people
times have changed, bro.
Yeah, I know in Canada you've got a band. Was it a band? I can't remember their name now. A Bhangra band.
We had a couple. We had a few. But again, the scene was here totally different than the UK. UK was the epitome of Punjabi Bhangra music, man. The problem with you guys, man, you're too accommodating. You'd like open the borders up. It's like, oh, ajo koina. And it fucked it up. You know what I mean? Like, let me listen. When's the last time you heard a UK rapper break in the US?
No. Yeah.
Right? I'm not talking about the Adeles or any of these like full on whatever. Right? They have the scene on lock. You lot had the scene on lock for years. You open the borders up and look what happened. Let's be real here. I remember at a point in time where I would come there on radio and I wouldn't even hear a UK song being played on radio. And I was like, what is this? Like,
when you mean open the border up, do you mean as in to
allowing indie artists to come and stay for like the whole season? Like, and there's, you know what? I have no disrespect for the artists, but allowing them to stay for a season to like basically take the scene over, right? Gary Sandu is an exception. He actually came to live there.
Yeah.
Right? That's different. He was there living there. But like when you have people, imports come in, you know, they'll stay for the season, kill the scene, go back. You know, Lember will come in, kill the season. What do you think is going to happen?
And I think people that want to see live musicians and artists, they get their fix from the artists from India now. And I know I was talking to Ninda Johal from Ajanak, and exactly his point. He goes, what happened in the UK was the audience got their fix of live music from Gurdasman, Diljit, and you know any other artist from India. And so they didn't really want the UK bands. So he goes, that's kind of when we went
to... I don't know, man. Because on the flip side, when UK was in its stride, you never heard a song from India being played on radio. So people want what they hear and what they see. Right? I remember no Canadian music ever played on in the UK. And vice versa, UK music never played here. It's mainly India. So you kind of like skipped over, came here. I'll tell Once you open those borders up, it changed.
I'll tell you a perception of Canadian music when I was younger and in Punjab radio.
Yeah.
We used to think, shitty remixes.
Yeah, it was. I was one who did them.
Yeah.
Monday in Black, man.
You know, they weren't that bad. But no,
I'm just, like in retrospect, but, I'm just saying it was a remix scene.
Yeah, I really remember that. They were really hardcore, very almost crude remixes of Punjabi songs, and I remember the album covers actually. They used to be very geared towards marijuana, and I remember a few of them. They used to have something like a weed connotation to them, and you know, sort of green sort of fonts, and you could tell it was about weed. But anyway, these are what I remember. But I remember being on Punjab radio and thinking, nah, they're all remixes. They're not nothing
shitty remixes,
But I think you guys have now, you've overtaken the scene. There's some great stuff coming out from your...
Bro, at the end of the day, man, we are tied to hip-hop culture. That's a fact. We're only giving what people want to play, like here.
Yeah.
Kids now in their car. Like, my girls listen to hip-hop. So what are you going to produce? Hip hop? Like, I'm shocked that no one's done a trap song in the UK. I'm shocked. That's what everyone's listening to. So why wouldn't you produce it? Like, music's got fashions, right? Like, the UK set the trends for Punjabi music, hands down. But shit's changed now.
It's changed.
Mani Sandhu is probably one of the few producers that gets that. He's got some great like trap influence records.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like you gotta produce, unless you got a fan base like a Gurdasman or a Babuman or like a Sidhu Moosewala, you know, who can basically put out anything, they're gonna eat it up. But you know, at the end of the day, you gotta produce music that people want to listen. Listen, we're not the buying power anymore, bro. We're not. We don't buy shit.
Yeah.
No one's... they stopped making music for us back in 2005.
Yeah.
Like, if you're not this, you know, at the end of the day, if you're not making music and mixing music for your laptop speakers or, you know, your speaker on your phone, you're done. Right? Things have changed, and that's why, you know, it's important that you got to keep with these trends. Like, the only reason I'm on social media is not because I want to make money out of anything. Like, I couldn't care less if you come to me or not. It doesn't bother me. There's some great engineers out there. My goal is that we have our own self, like the music, like I was talking about the wedding industry. We have a self-contained industry. Music, we do too, but it could be tighter, I think. You know, like the UK had from start to finish everything in-house. You know what I mean? You know, like India only uses India people. When they use us, it's like, you know, they start whining and complaining. Like, it's just a big clusterfuck.
Yeah.
Right. Like, and I always have disagreements with India artists because, you know, I think they don't have any clue what they're talking about. They're like, well, you don't have any clue what they're talking about.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. But, you know, you know, like, we're doing podcasts because that's what people are doing.
Yeah.
You know, it's not rocket science.
It's a strange one, because I remember when when you was podcasting, I was podcasting in the early days, it was a tough ask to get people to kind of convert them to listen, because they just didn't get it.
What's a podcast?
And they kept asking, oh, is it, how do I listen? What radio station is it going to be on? Is it on video? And I'd eventually say to them, look, it's like online radio. Yeah, you can listen to it when you want and turn it off when you want. But I remember them days and I think, it can't be this hard to know what a podcast is, because I knew podcasting was massive. Joe Rogan and, you know, all the podcasts out there, you know, thousands of them. They're massive, big hits, Serial. And I think, how don't upbringing people know about this stuff? This shit's the best thing ever in the world, right?
And, bro, man. You remember when MP3s were coming out?
Yeah.
We're still making CDs.
Yeah.
I mean, but that's the thing about this generation. They get it. Like, I talk to a lot of young producers, artists. Like, bro, like the urban stuff coming out of like Punjab, it's fantastic. Like, yeah, their hip hop scene.
Yeah.
Say whatever you want about it. You know, whether it's authentic or not, it's irrelevant. They've got a thriving urban hip hop scene, and it's great to see. Right? They still have, you know, somewhat respect to, like, you know, hip hop, but they got their own thing going.
They have. Who's that guy? Is it AP Dylan? Is that guy?
AP Dylan out here? Oh, buddy. International student, killing it.
Yeah. It's brilliant.
A guy that probably, you know, no one would ever care about if he did like regular Punjabi, you know, Dinga Naka Naka records. This guy's doing music straight for the girls.
Yeah.
And he's crushing it.
Yeah. And he's great. And, but I mean, look, we've been through so many subjects and this is our first get together. And
anything we missed or something you want to talk about?
No, I don't think so.
Because I know we kind of went all over the place.
But that's, you know, that's my shows. You know, they're like that anyway.
That's good.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, if there's anything specific, we can.
No. I reckon we could save it for another time. And
yeah, man, this was really good, man.
Yeah. Nice. You know, it's about conversations. It's about being open. And it's interesting how we have these conversations, but sometimes there's a thing on the back of our shoulder thinking, am I going to get any flack for this? Is there going to be anyone getting upset about this? But really, we haven't said anything for anyone to get upset about. No, it's not.
It's just, you know what? Anytime you bring up anything to do with religion or caste, it's just, like I said, we're, you know, the wounds are so fresh. So just people just take it out of context.
Mm. I don't know if caste is such a big thing here in the UK. I'm not sure. Maybe it is. And I'm just sort of, I'm getting old, you know, I'm going to be 45 myself.
Yeah.
I don't see none of this no more,
It's big here, especially with the younger generation, which I find really surprising.
Yeah.
It's really like, you'll go like drive around, you'll see like caste on their license plates.
No, you don't have that here. No, it probably is bigger out there than it is here.
Yeah. But again, it is what it is, you know?
Look, I mean, we're coming towards the end. I think we're cranking on to nearly 2 hours. You know that?
Wow. Has it?
What's time now? It's quarter past 10. Damn, what's the time where you are anyway?
2 o'clock. 2 p.m.
2 o'clock in the afternoon. It's quarter past 10.
You got a lot of editing to do, my friend. Tons of editing.
You know what? You know me. I don't do much editing.
Well, that's all right.
I don't do much. And people that come on said, oh, can you cut that bit? And I said, no. My conversation is my conversation, good or bad. If I said something wrong, you said something wrong. It's just a conversation. So don't worry about it. So no, I may do a bit here and there because I know you'll listen and I think, shit, he's a sound engineer. He's going to be...
Nah, man, it's all good. I ain't like that, man. I'm a listener first. I'm a fan first.
Yeah, no, I usually put them out uncut as they are. There you go. Let's see what people think. But we'll do another one once a month. I want to get some more international people on. I've had only people from the UK so far. And I've always said to you before, I wanted people from Canada because I know you've got a big Punjabi community out there and it's vibrant.
Appreciate that, man. That'd be good. You'd be the perfect voice for it.
And I think it'd be nice because it'd be nice for my listeners, because I've got UK listeners at the moment, but for them to sort, because I can be impartial, really. I'm not from Canada and they can kind of let rip if they want. And
I think it'd be great, man. I'm sure there's a lot of people that want to talk to you just to get some stuff out. This is actually pretty therapeutic, man.
Yeah, I've always had that, and I kind of like talking. And you know, I'm in a house full of women. You know, I've got two girls, I've got my mum's here, and so it was you, yeah. So I need to talk to some men. It's man talk, you know, sat man talk. You know,
sing movement, bro.
Sing, yeah. So no offense to the ladies, any ladies.
No offense.
Yeah, because you know, you can get in trouble for that as well, can't you, these days? So
no, but it's legitimate. I've had discussions about people. I think we do need a listen, man, it's about being better, right?
Yeah.
Like I've seen everything, man. I've been in like situations. I've been in like, you know, these men in change programs where I see like, you know, older sarde bande, you know, they were arrested for whatever. And, you know, they go to these therapy sessions because of, you know, like specifically for Punjabi guys, we've got our own issues. We're the only ones that can fix them.
Mm.
You know what I mean? Like you can't expect a Gora to come fix your issues with, you know, the cultural issues. Only we can fix them. So I don't mean Singh movement as a bad thing. It actually can be potentially be a good thing, because why wouldn't you want better men? Right? I'm sure there's guys out there that have been in situations where, you know, they've been abused and they can't go anywhere. Literally, they can't even talk about it. You know?
But, so that could be something for the future, I mean, you know, and but look, like I said, coming towards the end, it's been a great chat. I think, I don't know about you, I kind of feel lots been lifted off my shoulders here. You know, don't you think,
man, this is, you know, I've been through a lot of things. I've done a lot of things in my life. I thoroughly enjoyed this. Something I'm never going to forget. Oh, thank you, man.
Yeah. I'm not going to let you forget it, because I need your help tweeting it out. And
problem, bro.
Make sure you send it to Brown Twitter. All right.
I will.
You're my man in the trenches out there on Brown Twitter.
100%,
and,
man.
And I've got your back. If I ever see you getting caught up in any bullshit, I'll be there with my...
probably in 5 minutes, bro, as soon as I get on. So
yeah. But I'm absolutely pleasure. I knew it'd be a great interview with you, and because you speak your mind. I think you talk sense, to be honest. And
respect, bro. I appreciate that.
And I think that sort of upsets a lot of people out there, because they're idiots, basically. Let's do it again. Definitely. Let's do it once 100%. A month or something like that. You know?
I'm in, bro.
And we can put them out there, and it'd be fun. Aman, thanks for coming on.
You're welcome, my brother.
Ah, before I go, actually, I always do this. Is there any place that people can catch up with you, your work or your social media handles? Yeah, I mean,
I'm on Instagram at imdgreminis. Those of you that, you know, want to hear some of my work, I put a lot of my samples of my mixes and masters on there. If you want to catch me on a regular day-to-day, Twitter is the best, at @amenreminis. That one's at @amenreminis, yeah, AmenReminise. I'm very good at responding to people. I do what I can. I love helping people. That's how I've always been. Could be about anything. I'll try to reach out and do what I can, because I know it's tough out there, man. It's tough. It's tough to get the right advice, tough to get the right help. If I can help you, you know, set your way in your right direction, I'll do what I can.
That's great. I'll put all your social media tags on the notes as well. So whenever anyone's listening on the podcast, they'll have your tags on there. So, I mean, definitely going this time, definitely. And like I said, I don't know what I'm doing, mate. You know, I've been doing, how many years have I been doing this now, right? So,
you're an expert. Stop it.
Yeah. But okay, take care. We'll do this real soon. Thanks for coming on the show.
Thanks, bro.